Welcome to our review of Distilled, a game about crafting spirits from a brand new publisher, Paverson Games, who we have to thank for letting us take a review copy home from Origins 2023.
Distilled was designed by Dave Beck and features solo play by David Digby. Artwork is by Eric Evanson and is the first game published by Paverson Games. It was originally funded on Kickstarter and is currently up for pre-order on Paverson's website.
This booze-making board game has proven to be very popular and is being localized to a number of different countries by various different publishers. There are currently 9 different versions of the game out there from 8 other publishers.
Yeah, congratulations, Dave. Distilled plays 1 to 5 players and plays very well at all player counts. Now, Board Game Geek lists this as best at 3, and I'm not sure I agree with this unless you're just trying to get in a quick game during lunch or something like that. We found it plays just as good with 5.
The game length is very player count and AP dependent, which could be where the 3-player rating comes from. 2-player games take less than an hour, but our 5-player one was almost 3.
Now, Distilled is a board game about making spirits in a distillery. Each player has recently inherited a distillery along with its signature spirit recipe. Each round, they'll hit the market shopping for distillery upgrades, ingredients, new recipes, and useful items like barrels and bottles. Once everyone has gone shopping, it's now time to brew the booze using a uniquely thematic push-your-luck system. Players then choose to sell or age their spirits before moving on to the next round. Player with the highest reputation will be awarded the title of Master Distiller.
For a look at the components and the excellent game trays inserts that come with this spirited board game, check out our Distilled unboxing video on YouTube.
Yeah, the component quality here feels really top of the line. This feels like a deluxe super edition of the game, and we don't even have the cool upgrades like metal coins and metal recipe cubes. The game still feels deluxe and elegant. The game tray holders for the labels, money, and cubes work great, though the card holder at the bottom of the box only really works if you keep the game stored flat. The rulebook matches the component quality being extremely clear, and there are detailed reference cards for all players.
Next up, we're going to get into an overview of play for Distilled. While Distilled mechanics are tied well into the theme, and the game has a great flow to it, there's a lot going on, more than we want to cover in this review, so please don't consider this a full rules teach.
Now, the first choice you have when setting up a game of Distilled is which tasting board to use. There are 6 options here, and we quickly learn they make it quite a big impact on how the game plays. Now, not in the rules for the game. The rules are always the same, but what strategies are going to work and which are going to be favored and which combos are going to work best? Now, all players do use the same tasting board. This is a decision that's made as a group.
Once you choose a tasting board, you can set up the majority of the game following the rulebook, including filling the shelf board with labels that match your chosen tasting board. Watch for things that are based on your player count, like the number of labels and the number of spirit awards.
Next, each player chooses a color and takes their own personal distillery board and recipe clipboard. They're then dealt 3 distillery goals and 2 distiller identities. Each player is going to choose one of these identities to keep and then grabs the signature recipe, signature ingredient, and starting resources that are listed on that card. Each identity also has a game-breaking asymmetric special ability.
Each identity comes from a different region called their home region. There are 3 of these, Asia, North America, and Europe. The spirits on the recipe card also each come from their own region, though some show a home symbol. The region for these is your identity's home region.
Now, the game is played over 7 rounds, each of which has 2 phases. You start with a market phase, then you go to a distill phase. In the market phase, players use their money to buy things. These include unlocking new recipes on their recipe board, basic ingredients, which are always available to all players, buying premium ingredients and items that come from a randomized central market, which is refreshed as cards are bought, and distillery upgrades, which unlock more game-breaking bonuses. Now, a big thing to remember here is you can only buy 2 ingredients from the basic market each turn. This market represents a brewer's co-op with limited supplies and resources.
Ingredients come in a variety of forms: yeasts, waters, and sugars. Sugars themselves come in 3 types: grain, plant, and fruit sugars. The simple form of these are available in the basic ingredient market, but players will want to buy more expensive versions to distill better spirits.
Now, items include bottles to place your spirits in, your finished spirits, and barrels to age your spirits. Most bottles have regions on them, just like the spirits, and will give you extra points if you bottle a matching spirit in the proper bottle. In addition, players do score endgame points for their bottle collection, which is also region-based.
The most important thing everyone should be aware of during the market phase is that they need to have the ingredients to distill something every turn. Different recipes score different amounts of points and money, but the basic thing you need every turn is one yeast, one water, and one sugar. More advanced recipes may require multiple sugars of the same type, can't have certain types of sugars, or require a specific type of vessel to age. As the game progresses, leftover alcohol can be reused in recipes in place of yeast or water.
Which leads us to the distilling phase. Here, players simultaneously decide what ingredients to distill and make a washback deck out of that. There's a section of the board to kind of split up your cards to make sure you have a viable brew. This deck, again, must have one sugar, one water, and at least one yeast. Every sugar you have in your deck, you're going to add one alcohol card. You're then going to shuffle it all up and remove the top and bottom cards, returning them to your pantry to be reused in later turns. You then decide what barrel to put this brew in. Now, you do start with a basic metal barrel, but you can also use ones that were bought during the market phase.
Everyone then determines what they brewed by referencing their flight card. No matter what, as long as you have the basic ingredients to brew, you will end up with either moonshine, a spirit with no sugars in it, or vodka, a spirit with any mix of sugars. You will take the label for whatever you brewed and place it on top of your barrel.
Then in player order, players have the option to sell what they have brewed. Most spirits have to be sold on the turn they were made, but others require aging. They have to go into special barrels and are placed into the warehouse spot on your board, where they're going to start accumulating flavor cards for each round they're stored.
When selling, players pick a bottle to use, which can include the basic starter bottle all players get, or something they previously purchased. Players collect points and cash based on their mix as shown on the recipe card, as well as what cards made up the final batch. Premium ingredients provide more points and money than the basic ones.
Now, aged spirits can also be sold at this time, as long as they've been aged at least one round, and the process is the same, except you get bonus points based on how many flavors the spirit has picked up. The more flavors, the better. Individual flavor cards will also affect the value of your finished spirit.
For each spirit sold, you'll unlock a bonus by placing the label onto the top of your player board. These bonuses let you get things like ingredients, items, and upgrades for free, claim some extra cash, search through the truck, which is the market discard, for cards, or unlock your signature ingredient for use at any point during the game. This is a powerful tool, and why distilling something every turn is vital.
Now, signature recipes and ingredients are unique to each brewer identity and tend to be worth a lot of points and money. They're generally harder to brew than most of the other spirits in the game and require your signature ingredient to be in the final match. Thankfully, these have a special ability where if you remove them during distilling, you can put them back in. But that won't help you if you pull out another required sugar. If you use your secret ingredient and your batch fails, it's gone for good.
While all of this is going on, players also need to watch their identities, upgrades, and the modifications on cards, as these can all break the rules. In addition, players need to watch for chances to score the Spirit Awards put in play at the start of the game.
Each of these provides a first-come, first-served set of bonus points that players can claim during the round if they meet the criteria on the reward. Things like brew a batch with six sugars in it, or have eight alcohol in your final brew, or have your warehouse full of aging barrels, or brew spirits from all three regions, and so on. If more than one player claims one of these in the same round, everyone gets the points. That part's friendly. But once they're claimed, no one can get them in future rounds.
The game continues swapping between market phases and distilling phases, round after round, with the start player rotating and the market clearing a bit between phases. After the third round, players will choose one of their gold cards to discard, saving the other two for endgame scoring. Then, after the end of the seventh round, there is some final scoring to take care of.
Here, players are going to get points for any spirits still aging in their warehouse, but you do lose out on that flavor bonus, their completed bottle collection, points awarded by their distillery upgrades, distiller gold cards, and if they have, gold cards they've accomplished, and any leftover money.
The player with the most points becomes the master distiller, and in a cute bit of marketing gets an actual cardboard award. They encourage you to hold up and take a pic and share on Facebook and or Instagram.
Now, all of that sounds pretty overwhelming. There's a lot going on in Distilled. But, and I know it's a cliche for anyone teaching a game to say this, but it's way worse sounding than it actually is in play. The key to this is something we've talked about in the past, and that's how important it is and how well it works that the mechanics integrate with the theme here.
This covers almost all aspects of the game as well, including the fact that you have a recipe that holds your flight menu, the general market represents a distiller's co-op, and probably most notably, the way the during the distilling phase that you remove the top and bottom card from your deck. This directly relates to how actual distilleries remove the head and tail of their wash during the distilling process.
Now, because of this theme integration, Distilled is pretty easy to teach, and I've also found the rules easy to remember even if I go a month or two between games. Now, the box does include a first taste book that is great for onboarding new players, as it makes a lot of the initial decisions for you and walks you through the first few rounds of a game. But honestly, except for my first learning game, I've never felt the need to use this to show the game off to gamers, and even gamers with minor hobby game experience.
While I certainly have experience with heavier games, this really was utterly simple to pick up, and the reference cards, unlike some, only add to the ease of play. Often we might question something, and before Mo could find it in the rules, someone would note it off one side or the other of the reference card.
Yeah, they really are good. Distilled is just a very elegant game. It looks great, the theme matches the gameplay, and this has a flow to it that just feels good at the table. And that covers all phases. Well, yeah, there's sometimes some AP during the market phase. Things still go around the table pretty quickly, and honestly, when there is some IP, sometimes I've appreciated the extra thinking time myself. And then the fact that the distill phase is mostly done simultaneously makes that part of the game flow nice and quick. This leads to a surprisingly fast game.
As with most games, the more familiar you are with the cards, in particular the various distillery upgrades, the faster you'll be able to play, as you won't need to pause and read the available cards. And you'll be able to think up strategies further in advance with the knowledge of what's likely to come up.
Now, the thing is, quick here doesn't mean simple, easy, or light. Distilled is an engine building game where you start off with just basic ingredients and knowledge of simple recipes. You're going to build on that over time, learning new brews, upgrading your equipment, and collecting more expensive and rare ingredients. The thing is, you can never get everything you want. Yes, it's one of those games where money is tight, leaving you with hard decisions phase after phase, round after round.
Indeed, while you may be able to think of the strategies faster, that doesn't mean they'll be as optimal as with other players drafting from the same market and a limited number of labels available. Making the wrong mash at the wrong time can be disastrous.
Now, what's fascinating to me is that this brutal resource management and having to plan out things turns in advance is combined with a push your luck element. Every distill phase, you're taking a chance. That is, unless you go really overboard on ingredients and make sure no matter what cards you remove, you get the brew you want. But by doing that, you're going to limit yourself in other areas. Those ingredients come at the cost of upgrades or bottles or a variety of recipes. While it can be worth it sometimes, because there's nothing worse than losing your signature ingredient when failing to make your signature spirit, but pulling that off with just enough sugars can be one of the most rewarding experiences.
Financial management is vital in this game, as enough money means better ingredients, which means a better outcome from the still, and even more high-quality ingredients, and so on as your engine builds. But make a mistake. Brew something with no labels left, and you've suddenly lost a major advantage that could mean you're out of the running.
Well, not every batch of spirits is perfect, and there are a few things I think could be improved in this game. Now, I'm going to call this one out. I didn't have a problem with it, but my wife did not like the onboarding system presented by the first taste guide. She doesn't like any time the game tells you or people tell you what cards to play. Like, here's your starting hand, and on your first turn, you're going to take this action, and you're going to play this card, and you're going to buy this. If you have someone like that in your group, you're best to just go through the tasting guide, but just kind of set it up as a mock play and walk through it yourself. And then once you've gotten through those first two turns, just wipe it and start fresh.
On the other hand, we do encourage games to provide this sort of onboarding experience for less advanced players. So I really don't think that having it is a drawback at all. You just need to know who to use it for.
Yeah, I totally agree. Now, next up, despite my the love I shared during the unboxing video for the box insert, the top part's fine. I absolutely adore the money, the tasting cubes, the labels. Those all work great. Though finding one specific secret ingredient, special ingredient, signature, that's where signature ingredient is a little annoying, but they're great. The problem is the bottom part, the card part, that is divided up the whole cards. For one, they didn't tell you what to put where, which, come on, give me a sheet. Give me something that tells me what to put where. You can easily find it online. You can come up with your own solution. But second is, it looks like it holds everything in place. And I even did the thing where you put the, you know, the cardboard insert under it so it's nice and tight. Even with that, if not held perfectly flat, some of the cards are going to shift. Like this happened when I brought it from my basement to upstairs one day. Now, when I pack this game up or put it in my Kallax standing up behind me, it does bad things. Anytime I brought this out to public play events, when it's been stored vertically, I've had to spend a good 5-10 minutes or more sorting cards before we can play.
Indeed. While the insert looked fantastic, it was utterly useless in keeping the game materials separated and organized. And this wasn't shaken around or thrown in a trunk the last time. So
now the other potential issue here is, of course, going to be the randomness in the game. Because the teach and the theme and the overview of play and the initial play really makes this feel like a perfect open information heavy Euro, like something like a Splatter game, right? If it has that feel to it. But then you get to the distilling phase and there's that random push your luck element, right? Which, yes, it can be avoided, but it's there. While this is a fantastic catch up mechanic, I love the fact that, like Sean mentioned earlier, if you mess up a batch, you can then kind of shoot for the moon and try to brew some really good stuff with less ingredients. And if you get away for it with it, that tends to get you back into the race. You can do it, but that whole randomness is going to turn some players off.
Well, others will revel in the ways to minimize that randomness by stacking your wash with the right ingredients to pull off a triumphant batch of high quality hooch, only to have to stick it in a plastic bottle because they couldn't afford a nice one after buying all their ingredients.
Yep. Yes. Yeah, there's definitely a give and take there that I actually like. Honestly, overall, I like everything about Distilled pretty much. The only reason I'm nitpicking is because I feel like I don't want to be overly pie. I got to say something bad about the game, right? I love Distilled. Really, this is one of the best games in my collection at this point, and I have a large collection of games. I adore how well the theme integrates with the mechanics and how easy to pick up this game is and how easy to teach it is. As someone who runs public play events, having a game that's so well integrated and so easy to pick up is fantastic. Like, as a perfect example, this is one of my youngest daughter's favorite games, and she's the one with multiple learning disabilities. The way things are presented in Distilled just made sense to her. And even in her first play, she was challenging the point leaders right to the end of the game.
Now, while I'm not a drinker, and many games on the theme of brewing and vineyards just haven't done much for me, I really found this game sang and not only made sense, but felt thematic. If there was one aspect I might call out as slightly pasted on, it's the global regions, which, while important for endgame scoring and label names, just felt a bit too generic and were even minimized on the board in how small they appear on everything, making them rather hard to see and differentiate at a distance.
There you go. There, if we're going to call out one big problem with Distilled, it'd be a little problem. Iconography is a little small in all cases. We've complained about this a lot, and I got to say, those ones in particular are very hard to tell apart depending on the lighting you're under. I have to agree with Sean on that one. The regional symbols could have been way bigger, or just give me a big capital A, E, or something, or N for North America, A for Asia, E for Europe in big letters. I would like to see that, actually. So yeah, that's a good point. Now, the other thing I do like about this is how big a game it is while still playing in what I would consider a short, manageable time frame, especially at the low player counts. I can't think of many other games in my collection that pack this level of strategic brain-burny punch in about an hour with three or less players. Like, I get that feel of an epic, challenging game night in a nice short burst.
I was equally surprised with how we managed to fit a five-player game on a smaller dining room table. Now, it took a bit of planning, but it worked, and everyone had space for everything. The game can benefit from a bit more space, and it is important to try and make sure players, especially newer ones, can see and easily read the market.
I think anyone who enjoys engine building games, especially those that enjoy games that reward long-term planning, being presented with a set of restrictions and goals and being able to form a strategy from them are going to like Distilled. That's one of my favorite parts. When you start off and you look at that tasting board and you get your brewer and you decide which brewer to play, and you already are starting to think out your future turns, going, okay, I'm going to make this and I'm going to make this. I really love that. Though, be aware, if you don't like randomness, this is going to be part of the game. But that randomness, I actually think, is part of the highlight, and that's what's going to make this game appeal to fans of lighter games. combined with that ease of picking up and the rule gameplay, you basically getting, like, I think it's going to appeal to a wide range of gamers from the splatter crowd to the medium Euro fans.
And while I don't deny the randomness, you're shuffling a deck and pulling out cards, there are so many aspects to help mitigate it.
Yeah.
There are no dice being rolled here. These are just stacks of cards with ways in the game to cycle and check the decks, as well as overloading your wash to minimize the risk of loss. It's not perfect information, but I'm not sure it would feel all right if it were. Now, while there is a science to distilling, there's also an art to it as well.
Yeah, yet another way the game is thematic. Honestly, I'm having a hard time thinking of groups that probably won't enjoy this one at all. Sure, the theme may be wholly unappealing. If you are never interested in playing a game about alcohol, all the power to you, I fully understand. But as for mechanics, I think there's something here for a wide variety of game groups. Despite its depth, the game can be played pretty casually. So I guess I'm saying, unless you like only like dexterity games and party games, try to find a way to play Distilled.
And one note about the theme is this isn't at all about drinking.
No,
there's no drinking that takes part in this game at all. It's purely about the manufacture of spirits. So there you have our thoughts on Distilled, one of the best new game discoveries we made in 2023. Mm-hmm. A great example of a game that is made better by its theme, and which showcases how design mechanics around the theme can make even more complicated games sing.
Thank you for joining us for this review. While some spirits may be in order, if you did enjoy this segment, I invite you to tip your bellhops by buying us a coffee. You can do so at ko-fi.com, that's ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. While I can't promise I won't add some Irish cream to it, I can say we will be grateful.